Today, we are going to discuss the continuation of the previous class. Today's topic is self-financing colleges in India. India has come out with a novel scheme of self-financing colleges, private and self-supporting courses. Now there are 134 law colleges, that is 134 private law colleges are in India, and there are 7 private law universities and 680 engineering colleges. When we count the state-wise data or state-wise statistics, we can see innumerable self-financing colleges are there. After 2015, there is a mushrooming of self-financing colleges. The private sector has an upper hand in all the states. As far as degree and diploma courses in Ayurveda, homeopathy, physiotherapy, law, and in all fields, in all professional courses, self-financing colleges have an upper hand. In the discipline of law, some private institutions come forward, such as Symbiosis in Pune, Amity Law School at Delhi, and FICCI Institute of Intellectual Property Development at New Delhi. This institution, the FICCI, offers 6-month postgraduate diploma in intellectual property management, administration and law, and it is recognized by Ministry of Human Resource Development. IGNO also offers a diploma in intellectual property rights in association with the World Intellectual Property Rights Organization. This course covers patents, trademarks, copyrights, risk mitigation, designs, research and documentation. Self-financing colleges and centers of higher learning are to be welcomed, as these can relieve some of the burden on central and state governments and help the economy and society by providing professionally trained personnel. For instance, the Delhi state government has recently established Guru Gobind Singh Indraprastha University to offer, on a self-financing basis, professional courses like engineering, medicine, computer science, management, law, education and pharmacy. It has so many affiliated institutions also. Some of them are doing very well in terms of quality education, while others are working only for profit. Self-financing colleges are becoming popular in some southern states such as Andhra Pradesh, Karnataka and Tamil Nadu, in northern states such as Uttar Pradesh, Haryana, Madhya Pradesh and Delhi. These are acceptable to the central and state governments because they do not impose any financial burden on the exchequer and yet help meet market demands for trained personnel. Some of these institutions have the necessary links with top industries and business houses. Some of the public universities are also running vocational and career-oriented courses, such as Bachelor of Elective Education, Bachelor of Computer Application, Bachelor of Business Studies, and diploma in global business and mass communication on a self-financing and self-supporting basis under the UGC's new scheme of vocationalization of higher education. There are four models of self-financing colleges at the undergraduate and postgraduate levels. First one is the Manipal model, second one marketing model, third one sponsoring model, and fourth one franchising model. The Manipal model is based on the philosophy that those students who are willing to pay for the education should be provided the facilities to pursue the course of their choice. The Manipal Academy of Higher Education is a pioneer in self-financing higher education in India, in that it is completely managed and funded by a private enterprise. Under the marketing model, institutions that are run by both the central and state governments are allowed to start professional courses at the undergraduate level on a self-financing and self-supporting basis. Usually such courses are managed with the help of part-time or guest faculty. The sponsoring model is popular with the corporate sector as it can come to their rescue by providing the requisite managerial and executive personnel or reorienting existing personnel in the latest knowledge and technological skills. For instance, IIT Delhi is conducting course in MTech in telecom technology sponsored by Bharti Enterprise at the cost of 135,000 per student up to initial maximum of 10 students. Recently, the IIT Gorakhpur has started a course in law, that is their conducting course BTech LLB. Various other institutes are conducting courses such as construction technology, power generation and telecom technology for various corporate companies in India. The self-financing institution based on the franchising model, will have to follow the norms published by the affiliated universities. They also have to adhere to rules and regulations laid down by those universities with regard to payment, allocation seats and contents. There are various incentives for adopting privatization measures and for encouraging private sector and private investment in higher education in India. It would be futile to locate the causes of privatization within the state itself, nor can it be seen in the simple terms of emulating Western experiences in higher education privatization. It may be best described in terms of domestication of international trends in higher education or instrumentalization of domestic needs and aspirations. Each country occupies a distinctive position in the international arena as its patterns of behavior and outcome are affected by domestic politics and economics. As such, the very objectives and strategies of financing higher education may vary from country to country and with time, depending upon prevailing socio-economic conditions and the political culture. Different countries may react to different problems in different ways, and the policy outcomes may have a common appearance only by chance. On the other hand, there may be certain common factors responsible for certain political and economical changes, while the various affected countries may or may not interact with, learn from, or induce change in other countries. At the same time, different countries may or may not face similar problems, yet they may try to emulate certain policies through interactions with one another. Though the self-financing colleges under the private sector and self-financing courses affiliated with public universities and colleges have found favor with the increase in middle class in India, they are criticized by some in academia for eroding educational quality, for perpetuating socio-cultural disparities and economic inequalities, and for contributing to decline in moral values. The escalation of dowries, a rise in corruption, etc. Their sole aim seems to be profit, and we find a mismatch between demand and supply. For instance, many IT professionals and software consultants experience psychological trauma in the wake of layoffs several years ago, both in India and abroad. Additionally, the number of vacant seats in private engineering colleges in Andhra Pradesh is forcing them to admit students with the bare minimum of qualities. In fact, the motivations of profit and politics can be cited as the prime factors responsible for the phenomenal growth of private colleges and universities in India. Most of this growth has been by default and not by design. There is no coherent legislative direction or regulatory framework to guide his or her unwarranted growth. Though some of them are able to provide quality education and much needed training in information technology, most of them lack the necessary infrastructure and faculty for quality education. There are reports of some universities and colleges duping gullible students and their families by providing fake degrees, diplomas, and certificates. There are some foreign universities also involved in this sort of fraud. I have heard about some university in Sri Lanka which is providing a PhD degree. They are awarding PhD for minimum 20,000 rupees or like that. They are just giving a certificate. Thus, that person is not having any thesis. The candidate is not writing thesis, still he get a certificate at the expense of rupees 20,000. As we have stated earlier, there are some foreign universities also involved in this sort of fraud. The government cannot shy away from its responsibility of providing transparent information to students and their parents about the private colleges functioning in India. In this context, the question of autonomy versus accountability is crucial. On the one hand, private higher education requires autonomy, a vision for the future, secrecy, the risk-taking behavior on the part of top managers, come administrators due to their entrepreneurial power. On the other hand, political democracy calls for accountability, citizen participation, openness and transparency in policy making, administration, fee structure and common entrance test. This conflict is reflected in various Supreme Court judgments concerning private higher education in India over the last few years. There are some judicial interventions, and just mentioning, only a brief mentioning is made here. When the laws are unclear and both the central and state legislation is ambiguous about the setting and functioning of private universities, which quite a recent phenomenon in India, the judiciary is bound to intervene. Unsurprisingly, there has been a plethora of litigation during the last 3 to 5 years over common entrance examination, fee structure, the management quota, etc. In most recent judgments, we can see judiciary is very sharp in these matters. Few years back in 2005, in the case of Professor Yashpal Sharma and others versus State of Chhattisgarh, Supreme Court of India declared null and void all the private universities set up under Chhattisgarh Private Sector Universities Establishment Regulation Act of 2002. Professor Yashpal Sharma, a resident of Chhattisgarh and former chairman of the UGC, had taken the stance that all private universities set up under Section 5 of the Chhattisgarh Private Universities Act were illegal. There were 170 universities at the time. All were illegal as they had negated the role of UGC. Section 5 of this act had empowered the state government to establish a private university simply by publishing a notification in the official gazette and then by laying it on the table of the legislative assembly. In his challenge to the legality of this section, Professor Sharma did not take issue with the concept of private university per se, but with the way 117 private universities dropped in his home state in less than a year after the passing of the Private Universities Act in 2002. Most of them, he charged, were set in an indiscriminate and mechanical manner without having slightest regard to the availability of infrastructure, teaching facility or their financial resources. Many of them had absolutely no buildings or campuses and were running from one room tenements. It was also pointed out that these private universities were conferring degrees, diplomas and certificates for courses unapproved by the agencies responsible for higher education in the various states, such as UGC, AICTE, MCA, BCA, NCTE, etc. In fact, in the name of vocationalization and job-oriented courses, these private universities had started some short-term and long-term programs that were recognized neither by the state nor by the market. For instance, the organizers of one such university issued an advertisement seeking alliances with local nodal service centers. Universities in other states or open learning programs at the national level for the courses that had never been heard before. Since they enjoyed legal status, they thought they would be able to confer all sorts of degrees, such as member of the International Institute of Medical Science or fellow of the International Institute of Medical Science, like that. The state of Chhattisgarh, on the other hand, took the stand that it was very much within the rights of the state or even a private individual to establish a university under its constitutional provisions and subsequent court judgments. Then there are a lot of cases like TMA Pai versus state of Karnataka, then Unnikrishnan's case, Unnikrishnan versus state of Andhra Pradesh. A lot of cases you must have studied during LLB itself, so I am not going into the details of that cases, and I am concluding this chapter in this manner, that it is a mushrooming of a lot of private universities has badly affected the standard of the higher education in India.